Grace and peace be unto you from the Lord Jesus the Christ and from the Father. Children of God, I want you to know that on your behalf, I always thank God for his grace so that in all things you're enriched by him and you won't be lacking in any gift. I'm your professor, Dr. Stefeni. Welcome to the Master's Touch Masterclass. You know, these classes are designed to give you a firm foundation in the Word of God. And my friends, I want you to know that I pray that God may bless you richly on your journey to know Christ. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, flowing through our lips. We exalt you, we praise you and your holy name. Lord, we thank you for the hearts and the minds that are hungering for you and your word and to know your will. You know, we praise you for our Lord and Savior, your only begotten Son, Jesus the Christ, and what he did for us on the cross, his finished work. Thank you, Lord, for revelation knowledge, your rhema word, the logos word, and the gift of utterance. And bless those, Lord, that have ears to hear as you impart wisdom through your word. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Let me ask you, did you come expecting to receive from God today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from him. So elevate your expectation level. You know, when you do, you're going to come away with a greater revelation and a greater heart and mind connection, and you're going to get a better understanding of God's word. Now, we enter deeply into the presence of God by soaking in worship, so soak with me right now and let the Holy Spirit enter in. It's Christmas, and we know it. All right. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be wholly acceptable to you, and may my words be your words and your words be mine, and may they continually glorify you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You know, over all the vast series that we've studied, I taught you some things about your own makeup and some things about the makeup and power of the enemy. Now, as we go forward, we need to seek to understand the main principle that God has given us. This is the major positive operating feature of life. It is how to rest while working. Sound bizarre? Well, this one principle is the key to an effective and fulfilled life in Christ, and is applicable for both our personal, preventive, and corrective maintenance. It's another way of describing our walk of faith. Now, the approach that we're going to be taking here may seem a bit strange, but it involves the study of the most unlikely subject in the area. It's the Sabbath. But as we proceed, I think you'll agree that God's teaching us a vital truth. Through this kind of obscure subject, we're going to get a vital truth. So let's take a look at what the Sabbath is all about, shall we? There's a remarkable lack of basic understanding about out there about the Sabbath, and it's most likely not without good reason. I say that because right in the midst of God's commandments, covering the most significant and far-reaching moral and spiritual issues, there's this seemingly semi-relevant word. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your manservant or your maidservant, or your cattle, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and so on. All right? Now look, for such a seemingly inconsequential matter, the Lord speaks a considerable length on this particular subject in contrast with thou shalt not kill, found in Exodus 20, verse 13. And a few of his verses later, he just has 4 words to say about murder, but 94 words on the Sabbath. Why? Well, is the Sabbath really that important? You know, so many of us don't really pay any attention, actually the slightest bit of attention, to this fourth commandment in God's law. So what happened? Well, did God make a mistake? Is his word less than inspired? What exactly is wrong with this picture? Now, I've learned that any apparent anomaly in the Word of God is a clue that absolutely shouts out loud for further investigation. And usually, further study will reveal an extremely significant truth. God likes to intrigue us and coax us into thinking. I love God because He is so wonderful in how He guides us and piques our curiosity. It's like being a detective. You can't hardly wait till you see all the clues so that you can figure out what's going on. It's the glory of God to conceal things, but the glory of kings is to search things out. Proverbs 25, verse 2. See, it's even in the Bible. That scripture is talking about us, my friends, as kings. The word king is not capitalized, and we are kings, not capitalized. So let's be what we are designed to be. God's royal family, shall we? You know, I have several lengthy books in my library concerning the Sabbath, and they completely miss the point. There are Sabbatarians and their sects that do likewise. So many have argued for lifetimes about which day to keep as the Sabbath, only to obscure the real issue and miss the point of God's truth. The Sabbath was a key issue with the Jews in our Lord's day, but neither then nor now does there seem to be very much light focused on its real significance. It seems like we tend either to overwork the subject in a legalistic, nitpicky way, or else to slide right by it without trying to discover the real importance of the Sabbath. Now, perhaps the best way to begin our investigation of the Sabbath and its significance is to confront some of the obvious problems that are there about it and ask some crucial questions. Here are some rather mind-boggling and somewhat puzzling facts for you to consider. Number one, all the commandments, with the exception of the Sabbath commandment, are repeated in the New Testament. For instance, honor your father and your mother, Exodus 20, verse 12, is repeated in Ephesians 6, verse 2. Also, do not lie to one another, Colossians 3, 9, is the equivalent of you shall not bear false witness in Exodus 20, verse 16. Number two, there is no equivalent to the Sabbath commandment given in the New Testament. On the contrary, in the New Testament we read, one man esteems one day as better than another, while another man esteems all days alike. Let everyone be fully convinced in his own mind, Romans 14, verse 5. Then three, the Lord Jesus seemed to take particular pains to do some of his works on the Sabbath day. For example, John chapter 5, verses 2 through 18. Listen to them. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" And the sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath. Now the Jews therefore said to him who was cured, "Is it the Sabbath? Is it not lawful for you to carry your bed?" And he answered them, "He who made me well said to me, take up your bed and walk." Then they asked him, "Who is this man who said to you, take up your bed and walk?" But the one who was healed didn't know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn, a multitude being in that place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who made him well. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, "My Father's been working until now, and I've been working." Therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Okay, it seems there's something wrong here, a glaringly inconsistency between the testimonies of the Old and the New Testaments. So let's try to unravel the puzzle by asking and answering some crucial questions here. What does Sabbath mean? 2, to whom was the Sabbath given? 3, what is God's intent in the Sabbath idea? And 4, is there a New Testament parallel or fulfillment of the Sabbath? And if so, what is it? So in regard to the first question, years ago, before I became a Bible scholar, I used to think that Sabbath meant seventh, since it was the seventh day. But now I know that Sabbath is from a Hebrew word which means rest. Keep that in mind, because its significance carries all the way through our study. The Sabbath was given as a command to the nation of Israel and was invested by God with a sign character. "Say to the people of Israel, you shall keep my Sabbaths, for this is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I, the Lord, sanctify you. Therefore, the people of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, observing the Sabbath throughout their generations as a perpetual covenant. It's a sign forever between me and the people of Israel." Exodus 31, verse 13 and 16 through 17. "Therefore, for this reason," he says, "the Lord commanded Israel to keep the Sabbath." For what reason? It was to help them to remember how the Lord redeemed them from slavery. After all, it should have seemed like a pretty good idea to them, since they had been 7 days a week slaves. You can see the Sabbath was to be a time of memorial and meditation on God's redemptive work of freeing them from the slavery that they had been encumbered by. So the law, including the Sabbath command, was not given to the Gentile nations. When Gentiles who have not the law, Romans 2, verse 14. Nor was the commandment given to the Christians. "Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in question of food and drink, or with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath." Colossians 2, verse 16. So what's it all about? Should we ignore the whole business unless we happen to be Jews? No. Let's not give up too soon. Remember, 1, that we need to try to discover God's intent in the Sabbath idea, and 2, that the nation Israel is designed to picture the individual Christian believer so that we will learn from Israel's history. Our reference for that is 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11. "Now all these things happened to them as examples, and they were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages have come." Okay. Now, in giving the Sabbath command to Israel, I want you to notice that the Lord relates it to the creation account in Genesis. "For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." Exodus 20, verse 11. Apparently God wanted his people to reflect back on the rest that God was enjoying following his creative activity, as we read in the Genesis account. So God blessed the seventh day because on it God rested from all of his work which he had done in the creation. Genesis 2, verse 3. Well, okay, but what's the nature of his rest? Was God tired? Did he run out of energy? Well, if we understand that God is the source of all power, all energy, then it's clear that he was not suffering from an energy shortage. And according to Isaiah, he doesn't get tired because the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. Isaiah 40, verse 28. What then is the nature of this rest? Well, first it seems obvious that God has ceased from his activity. So inactivity is part of it. But there's more. When God had finished his work of creation, the account in Genesis says this: God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. Genesis 1, verse 31. The Lord was simply enjoying his creative handiwork. And this is the key ingredient in God's rest: his entering into and enjoying all that he had made. So the first clue as to God's intent in the Sabbath, then, is this picture of the God of creation relaxing and enjoying the result of his work. This peaceful rest of God, however, was brought to an abrupt end. In the very next chapter of Genesis, chapter 3, we read of the entrance of sin into the picture, and God had to start working all over again. Because of his great love, he couldn't rest apart from his creation, man, and he couldn't rest in man because he had turned away from God. His first work was the work of creation, but now he engages in the work of recreation, the redemption of an alienated race of men to make them part of a new creation. Now, the balance of the biblical record is the account of God's redemptive work to restore that rest that was lost through sin. That rest that was lost was both God's and man's. We see man's need for re-entry into that rest in scriptures such as these. Therefore, while the promise of entering his, God's rest, remains, let us fear lest any of you be judged to have failed to reach it. Hebrews 4, verse 1. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for whoever enters God's rest also ceases from his labors as God did from his. Hebrews 4, 9 through 10. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest. Hebrews 4, verse 1. Now, on God's side of the question, we see that the restoration of rest for him comes through the responsiveness of men's hearts in the obedience of faith. In Isaiah 66, we read this: Thus says the Lord, Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What is the house which you would build for me, and what is the place of my rest? Isaiah 66, 1. Now notice that the universe is just so much furniture to God. Here the Lord asks the most pointed question of all time: Where do you think I should live? And where is the place I can call home and enjoy my rest? He answers his own question in the next verse. This is the man to whom I will look, he that is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Isaiah 66, verse 2. What will God look to this man for? Well, is it not for the place where he can rest and feel at home? And what makes it possible? Is it not the inward attitude of that man's heart? Humility, the opposite of pride, contrition of spirit, the opposite of hypocrisy and cover-up, trembling at God's word, the opposite of ignoring God or resisting him? You see, these are the things that make God feel at home and at rest in the heart of man. The heart of man, who denies God entrance, is the only place in this universe, in the universe, not just this one, but the entire universe, where God is denied access. Hell is going to be an internal pain, a pain in the heart of God, because the ones who go there refused him. They refused him a home. They resisted his offer to enjoy the life and presence of the one who made them and who has yearned to restore the rest that they've missed. The ultimate expression of missing God's rest is hell. While the current evidence of men having missed God's rest is the restlessness of the age, men looking everywhere and trying everything except God to gain the satisfaction and fulfillment that they lack. You know, it's no wonder Christ pleads, Behold, I stand at the door and knock, Revelation 3:20. He's saying, Won't you let me in? If you notice in the pictures of the Bible that have pictures, the Jesus is standing outside the door knocking. There's no door handle on that door. You have to open it and let him in. And he's saying, Won't you let me in? Let's return to God's key examples. From God's key examples, we are to learn something, and I want you to look at Israel's heart. In response to God's appeal recorded in his word to the Hebrews, he says, "Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion of Israel on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your fathers put me to the test and saw my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was provoked with that generation and said, they always go astray in their hearts. They have not known my ways. As I swore in my wrath, they shall never enter my rest." Hebrews 3:7-11. Now, as we look at Israel's history referred to here, keep in mind that the nation of Israel pictures each one of us in a very personal way. Through the graphic illustration of the victories, trials, and failures of the Hebrew nation, the Holy Spirit means to teach us about God's special love and provision for us, as well as to reveal to us the stubbornness of our own hearts. What got the Israelites into the wilderness situation in the first place? It was unbelief. Hebrews 3:19. Thus they failed to enter into all that God had made ready for them, pictured by the land of Canaan, to enjoy his rest in the place of spiritual victory. Did they have to remain in the wilderness for 40 years? No, absolutely not. It appears that the journey to the promised land could actually have been made in a few weeks. That's really sick, isn't it? Did God know about the obstacles they faced? Yes, of course he did. He promised his victory over them. What's the name of the leader who finally took Israel into the land? It was Joshua, which means the Lord God saves. What is your leader's name? His name is Jesus, and the English equivalent of Joshua. He is the Lord God who saves. After these sober reminders, the writer of Hebrews has this word for us: let us therefore strive to enter that rest, that no one fall by the same sort of disobedience. Hebrews 4:11. In order to analyze something, you usually have to pull it apart or break it down into its basic components. We have that situation here. Now, a lot of little pieces labeled Sabbath lying around, but we only have a vague idea of how they're supposed to fit together again. Who puts all these pieces together for us? Jesus does. He's the New Testament parallel and fulfillment of the Sabbath, and he's the reason the Sabbath command was not given in the New Testament. Instead of a command, Jesus issues an invitation. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Matthew 11:28-29. Do you get it now? Are you seeing it? Our Lord invites all who are tired of going it alone, struggling under a heavy load, to join up with him. See now what the Sabbath is all about? So then there remains a Sabbath rest, Greek sabbatos. Tismos, that's the Greek for it, the only occurrence in the New Testament for the people of God, Hebrews 4:9. So then there remains a Sabbath rest, sabbatismos, the only occurrence. That's the only occurrence in the New Testament for the people of God. We find our rest by faith in our living Lord. He finds his rest in the obedient and loving response of our hearts as we keep on trusting him. Life is intended to be our enjoying him and his enjoying us. That brings us to resting while working. What does the Sabbath commandment say to us? Is it irrelevant? Far from it. It points to the most vital aspect of Christian life, the rest that comes from counting on the one to whom you're yoked, the Lord Jesus, for every need of your life. The result, he says, is that you will find rest for your souls, Matthew 11:29. So the soul, remember, is the emotional, mental, and willful aspect of our being. Who doesn't need a mind at rest, emotions at peace, and a securely anchored will? But what's the yoke all about? A yoke is a working device designed to team up two animals to work together. What does our Lord promise? He says, I will give you rest. Do you suppose he could be talking about resting while working? Now that's an attractive proposition, isn't it? I'm sure that all of us have discovered the difference between work and toil. We can be working very intensely at some things and enjoying every minute of it, resting while we're doing it. Or we can be really laboring at some totally unappealing and odious chore and hating every minute of it. What the Lord is offering is a working partnership to make all of life a joy instead of a drag. That's why he says, for my yoke is easy, pleasant, not harsh, and my burden is light. Matthew 11:30. Now, as someone has said, the rest that Christ offers is not a rest from work, but a rest in work, not the rest of inactivity, but of harmonious working of all the faculties and affections of will, heart, imagination, conscience, because each has found in Christ the ideal and only sphere for its satisfaction and development. That comes from J. Patrick in Hastings Bible Dictionary and Vine's Expository Dictionary of the New Testament. So you know where I got it. So how do we do it? We come to him and learn from him as he invites us to do. Herein lies the key which unlocks all the abundance of life and joy, which is our heart's desire. This is what the Sabbath is all about, my friends, and far from being out of place in the Ten Commandments. It actually has the most far-reaching significance for Israel and us. You see, Israel missed God's deeper intent for the Sabbath when they took it as bondage instead of blessing. We miss it when we fail to see that the Sabbath concept for the Christian is not the observance of a day, but rather a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week, 365 days out of the year, resting by faith in the sufficiency of our strong Lord. Now, I know a person, a Christian, that everything is going wrong for. He can't make enough money. He owes everybody. His wife is divorcing him. He's emotionally all shook up. He's doubting God's goodness. His life is in turmoil. And in short, he's definitely not enjoying rest. He's troubled and he's miserable. Is God being unfair to him? Doesn't God keep his promise to supply our needs? Is he faithful? Is he unfaithful, I mean, hey. Well, there's one thing that I failed to mention. He's persisting in participating in a sexual immorality. And as a result, as the Lord says, there is no rest for the wicked. Learn from me, Jesus says. But this man isn't listening or learning. He's persisting in being just plain wicked. No wonder he has no rest for his soul. No wonder his heart is troubled and his life is a shambles. Do you see how our choices determine the degree of rest we enjoy? If I walk by faith, I enjoy rest and victory. If I am, let's say, disobedient, I will end up wandering through a wilderness of self-induced trouble and heartache. We can have it either way. It's our choice to make. Though God doesn't get tired, we can surely make him weary. Dr. Willard Aldrich beautifully spells out the theme of the weariness of God. Does God get tired? Well, what could weary the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, who does not faint or grow weary? Isaiah 40:20. What could possibly tire the one who created a universe of throbbing energy? Molecules in motion, suns radiating heat, galaxies of heavenly bodies hurtling through space, all bear witness to the boundless energy of omnipotent God. What could weary such a God? The prophet Isaiah not only reveals that God neither faints nor grows weary, but that he renews the strength of those who wait upon him so that they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Isaiah 40, verse 31. Yet this God is said to be made weary. What can weary God? Four things are said to weary God. Religion that has degenerated into mere form and ceremony wearies God. The religious observances which he had ordained for ancient Israel, but which were being celebrated without regard to their spiritual significance and moral requirement, were a stench in the nostrils of God. Your new moons and your appointed feasts my soul hates, they have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. Isaiah 1:14. Could your religion be weariness to God? God wearies of the unbelief of men who will not hear his word and trust his promises. Such is the story of King Ahaz, who reigned in Judah about 700 years before Christ coming into the world. King Ahaz refused to ask for a demonstration of God's power when God, through his prophet Isaiah, commanded him to ask for a sign. And Isaiah rebuked his unbelief and disobedience to God by saying, "It is too little for you to weary men that you weary my God also." Isaiah 7, verse 13. Are you guilty of wearying God through your unbelief and disobedience? Have you obeyed God's command to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? God will judge those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 8. God grows weary of our sin. Isaiah charged the nation Israel with wearying God by persistent wickedness. He voiced God's complaint, "You have wearied me with your iniquities." Isaiah 43, verse 24. See, many voices are being raised today to say that how we live is a mere matter of indifference. Either God doesn't care or there isn't a God to care. But do not be deceived by such deceitful voices, my friends. There comes a time in God's dealings with men and nations when he so tires of their iniquity that he gives them over to judgment. Now, preceding the destruction of the world by the flood in the days of Noah, God said this, "My spirit shall not abide in man forever." Genesis chapter 6, verse 3. Nothing wearies God more than man's attempts to justify evil conduct. And the justification of evil is characteristic of the day in which we live. So this so-called new morality throws off the restraint of God's moral law and judges things evil which are acceptable to society as no longer to be considered evil but good. I mean, get a life. Come on. But God wearies of such perversion of moral truth. Of this weariness, the prophet Malachi wrote this: You have wearied the Lord with your words, yet you say, How have we wearied him? By saying, Everyone who does evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delights in them. Or by asking, Where is the God of justice? Malachi 2, verse 17. This is Old Testament, my friends. That tells you that everything, Solomon said it, there is nothing new under the sun. It's all repetition of the same old, same old. Those people were just like us. And look at what they're saying here. Malachi is saying the same thing that's happening to us today. Such divine weariness is a prelude to divine judgment, my friends. And although God is rich in mercy, gracious and long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, yet he grows weary of religious hypocrisy, unbelieving disobedience, ungodly iniquity, and justification of evil, as though it were good. It's bad enough to fall into sin. It's proof of deep moral disorder when God's moral standards are distorted so that wrong is called right and evil is considered good. Is it possible that God has grown weary of religious formalism, unbelief, wickedness, and self-justification in you? Well, you know, the only way we can truly be effective in helping anyone to spiritual victory and emotional stability is by entering God's rest ourselves and then showing others how to do the same. In a world full of turmoil, there's a quiet island of peace and confidence in which we can live by trusting the one who, we can trust the one who said, Come to me and I will give you rest. Why do we rob ourselves of this rest? Why do we weary God with our blatant disregard of an unbelief? Why do we rob God of his rest in us? We don't need to. There is a rest for the people of God, my friends. We left one open question of those what we posed at the beginning of this lesson. Why did the Lord Jesus seem to take pains to do his works on the Sabbath? And did he break the Sabbath law? Well, first of all, it seems apparent that the one who said he came to fulfill the law would definitely not act in violation of it. But how do we square this with his actions recorded in John 5, verses 2 through 18, where he healed a lame man on the Sabbath and instructed him to carry his bed when they're not supposed to do any work? What I want you to see is that the actual instruction given by God through Moses in the law did not forbid either healing someone or carrying a bed or a mat on the Sabbath. We see then that these legalistic Jews, bound by their own additions to what God had said in the law, were quick to accuse the Lord on the basis of their own traditions. So neither of these charges that Jesus violated the Sabbath is valid. They're not true. But there are also the Lord's own statements on the Sabbath. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Mark 2, verse 27. And the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath. Matthew 12, verse 8. And so it is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. Matthew 12, verses 1 through 126. All these statements touch on a deeper intent of the Sabbath and cut right through all the legalistic mess and surface issues. Now, going back to John 5, it tells us this was why the Jews persecuted Jesus, because he did this on the Sabbath. John 5, verse 16. But Jesus answered them, My Father's working still, and I'm working. John 5, 17. Now, this brings us full circle, folks. Originally, the Sabbath was connected with the creative activity of God in his resting to enjoy his creation. Then sin entered, and he had to go to work all over again. Then at Sinai, the Sabbath was invested with the significance of being a memorial to God's redemptive actions in redeeming Israel from slavery in Egypt. In all of this, the Jews apparently never caught the real significance and value of rest, whether physical or spiritual. Now, the Lord Jesus identifies himself with the Father in his work, work made necessary by the unbelief of man, and work dedicated to man's restoration to harmony with the purposes of God, enjoying his rest. Did our Lord really break the Sabbath? Well, his own words give us the answer. Jesus said to them, Truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing, for whatever he does, that the Son does likewise. John 5, verse 19. Here is one who can say, I always do what is pleasing to him, the Father. John 8, verse 29. That means he keeps perfectly the intent and the spirit of the Sabbath because he always walked by faith, enjoying the rest of God. Therefore, our Lord is the perfect example of how to keep the Sabbath in accordance with its original intent and purpose. This is a fact that is seen by the perfect poise and composure he enjoyed and displayed in his earthly life and ministry. He was never flustered or hurried, not hounded and harried by time and circumstances as we so often are. His life is a perfect display of resting by faith in the sufficiency of his Father's loving care. No wonder he says to us, "Come to me, take my yoke, learn from me, and you will find rest. Because as the living Father sent me," he says, "and I live because of, by the Father, so he who eats me as bread of life will live because of or by me." John 6, verse 57. Do you like life? Do you appreciate rest? They are only available in Jesus Christ. There's a great old hymn that says it so well. "Jesus, I am resting, resting in the joy of what thou art. I am finding out the greatness of thy loving heart. Thou hast bid me gaze upon thee, and thy beauty fills my soul, for by thy transforming power thou hast made me whole. Oh, how great thy loving kindness, vaster, broader than the sea. Oh, how marvelous thy goodness lavished all on me. Simply trusting thee, Lord Jesus, I behold thee as thou art, and thy love so pure, so changeless, satisfies my heart. Ever lift thy faith upon me as I work and wait for thee, resting neath thy smile, Lord Jesus, earth's dark shadows flee. Jesus, I am resting, resting in the joy of what thou art. I'm finding out the greatness of thy living heart." That was written by Jean S. Piggott in the 19th century. I hope you received this today. I pray that you did. If you have questions or need further assistance with understanding the message, contact me. Website, themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. Email me at masterstouchhs@gmail.com. That's masterstouchhs@gmail.com. I want to invite you all to join Pastor Karen Weitzman and myself every Monday right here on Spreaker.com at 10 a.m. for Pacific time for Living the Word. In this program, we will continue teaching you how to apply the Word and promises of God to your life daily. So come join us following this broadcast every Monday at 10 a.m. Pacific time on Spreaker.com, and come expecting to receive. Remember this. Proverbs 4, verse 7 tells us that wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and in all of your getting, get understanding. And that's exactly what we're doing here, dear ones. We are gaining God's wisdom, so be sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. The Master's Touch Masterclass is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We are a 501c3 organization. I will see you again here in the Master's Class on Monday at 9 a.m. Pacific time, right here on Spreaker.com. God bless you.